campus and made it down. Thank you for coming. For all of you that are up there, I hope you enjoy on YouTube. Welcome to First Congregational Church, United Church of Christ, Grand Junction, Colorado. It's wonderful to see you all here. It's wonderful to be here. There are just a few announcements I'd like to make. Let's see. Oh, very important. Special event for kids, family, or anyone who feels like a kid. There will be a movie time Sunday, August 21st, following the fellowship hour, and it's going to be Sleeping Beauty. There will be sandwich makings, including peanut butter and jelly, chips, cookies, and drinks. And there will be a good offering, goodwill offering taken to cover the cost. Popcorn will be available to lunch on during the movie, so you don't have to load up on cookies and coffee beforehand. There are a few other things. As you know, Pastor Paul and Pam are on vacation this month, so we're hoping they're having a great time and getting relaxed. There are some of us that were asked to step in, and I want to thank everyone who volunteered to do it, Ken and who else? Oh,
Andrea.
Yes. Okay, good. Mission and Outreach August election is in support of Child Migrant Services again. They're looking for insect repellent, sunscreen, calamine lotion, bandanas. And, you know, individual size Kleenex, hand cleansers, cough, throat drops, any of that stuff will really help them out. Catholic Outreach is continuing their collection of drinks. So I would invite you, we collected, we want to collect another 100 to 200 cans of drinks for those who are suffering through this heat that we've had. And Mission Outreach has an ongoing collection for solidarity, not charity, and that would be personal-sized toiletries, water jugs, and their lids, plastic grocery bags. And we are looking for a custodian, as Paul said last week. Anna has done a wonderful job for us, but is being called from another function, very important. So if you know of anyone was looking for about 15 hours a week to take care of the facilities, contact Beth, contact the office. She's the go-to for everything. And as we always say in our invitation to worship, whoever you are and wherever you are, I just say you are welcome. Paul usually has a very insightful opening reflection. And I was thinking today about everything that's going on in the world, and a poem came to mind that has guided my life for years. And that's Desiderato by Maxwell Reilly. Go placidly amid the noise and haste, and remember what peace there may be in silence. As far as possible, without surrender, be on good terms with all persons. Speak your truth quietly and clearly. Listen to others, even the dull and the ignorant. They too have your story. Avoid loud and aggressive persons, for they are vexations to the spirit. If you compare yourself with others, you may become vain and bitter, for always there will be greater and lesser persons than yourself. Enjoy your achievements as well as your plans. Keep interested in your own career, however humble. It is a real possession in changing fortunes of time. Exercise caution in your business affairs, for the world is full of trickery. But let this not blind you to what virtue there is. Many persons strive for high ideals, and everywhere life is full of heroism. Be yourself, especially do not feign affection. Neither be cynical about love, for in the face of all aridity and disenchantment, it is as perennial as the grass. Take kindly the counsel of the years, gracefully surrendering the things of youth. Nurture strength of spirit and shield you in sudden misfortune. Do not distress yourself with dark imagings. Many fears are born of fatigue and loneliness. Beyond a wholesome discipline, be gentle with yourself. You are a child of the universe, no less than the trees and stars, and you have a right to be here. And whether or not it is clear to you, no doubt the universe is unfolding as it should. Therefore, be at peace with God, whatever you conceive it to be. And whatever your labors and aspirations, in the noisy confusion of life, keep peace with your soul. With all its sham and drudgery, broken dreams, it is still a beautiful world. So be cheerful. Try to be happy.
Good morning. Please join me in the call to worship. Our loving God gathers us from the east and the west, from the north and from the south. We cried out to our God in the time of trouble and eased our distress. Our provider satisfies our thirst and meets our needs.
Holy God, is in our midst. Let us be clothed in love and compassion for our neighbors and ourselves.
Saw in the school that kind of shy. Yeah.
you see any at your school?
No. No.
Did you know everybody in yours?
No.
Well, I was one of those ones. I was one of those new kids.
I was.
Yes.
About your age.
And it was...
I was in first grade. I went to a new school.
And I didn't know anybody because we were in a new neighborhood. And I sat back in my blue desk. And I remember this day looking at all these little kids that I didn't know. And I had a friend. But one boy came up to me. Mike Dyer, he was redheaded, moved everywhere. He drove the teachers crazy. But he came up and he introduced himself and said, "Hey kid, are you new here?" I said, "Yeah." He said, "Well, we might as well be friends." And you know what? Mike and I were friends clear through high school. And I still talk to him today. So I think if you can find somebody in your class that you don't know, that doesn't know you or seems shy or alone, go up and say hi. Good for you. That's a good thing to do. You already did that. And you know what? You'll make that person feel so much better. And you may end up becoming a lot. So let's say a little prayer. Lord, thank you for new situations, the opportunities for new friends.
readings for today are from 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 32 and 33, and the Gospel of John chapter 13, verses 34 and 35. Give no offense to Jews or to Greeks or to the Church of God, just as I try to please everyone in everything I do, not seeking my own advantage, but that of many, so that they may be saved. And from John, I give you a new commandment, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another.
Thank you, Ellen.
While Pam and Paul are on vacation, and I think some of us are privileged and scared to death to be here talking to you, and I'm one of those who is both. I'm certainly no Bible scholar, so I can't give you great wisdom. I can only give you what I've learned, and that's what I'm here to do today. I chose love and respect, and I wish I had reversed it to respect and love. For a little background, I was at the annual celebration for the Rocky Mountain Conference about 5 years ago, and as lay delegate for the church and as a musician, and something happened. Being around those wonderful people and the Spirit, I realized I need to reclaim the Spirit that was given me at birth. And that led me today to the subject of love and respect. My thesis is that actually, if we all paid attention, the Bible would be a pamphlet. Because it has four basic things in it, and what I've seen through all the parables, all the Acts, anything that was transferred through the disciples, and that is, respect your fellow humans. Respect yourself. Love your fellow humans, and love yourself. Everything I've gleaned, I'd like to get things down to boil it down to something very simple. If we were to pay attention, God would have just had to say, okay, this is what you do, because I feel that way about you. Because you are mine. But we don't catch on real quick. You know what? It's always good to have visual aids. And I see that as a shining plate with the four corners: respect yourself, respect your fellow human beings, love yourself, love your fellow human beings. Unfortunately, it seems to me that gets somehow polluted by our egos, by our upbringing, all kinds of things. But it still comes down to those four basic things. And so I kind of want to work with those today and just give you an idea of what I have grown through. And it may ring true with some of you as well. First thing is respecting your fellow humans. Now, I first have to say, all parents do the best job they can. Because we are all products, just as in desiderata, of our environments. I grew up in a conservative state, in a conservative town, in a conservative family.
not better than you, you're not better than me. Because if I think I'm better than someone, I will not respect them. And that's a choice we all make. We think we can, but we choose not to. But we're told not to hold anyone in judgment, as in, judge not, lest ye be judged likewise. Respect for your fellows has been a problem at the forefront very recently, but in reality, it's been going on for centuries and even millennia, as in proved by the Old Testament. There were certain things in my household that were evident, because my folks both came from a conservative background as well. And those were judgments. Those judgments lacked respect. For instance, this may sound familiar to some of you, Martin Luther King was nothing more than a rabble rouser. Peace protesters were privileged. It's not those kids who ought to be just sent off to Russia if the U.S. is so bad. Poor people were just too lazy to work. Each one of those is not what God wants from us, and each one of those is a dent in that beauty. Negroes and Mexicans were both stupid and lazy. And my folks were educators. And they had a propensity to steal and cheat. Homeless, which we referred to as tramps, were nothing more than drunks and white trash. Fortunately, we're more enlightened now. These are the messages I got growing up that our kind deserved respect. But that wasn't the case for everyone. And that was a Christian home. And I think many of you have been in similar homes. And I'll say again that all parents do the best job they can. And they think they're doing right. And I don't have a problem with that. Respecting yourself. Let's see. Children are to be seen and not heard. We weren't allowed to disagree or challenge anything. I don't know how many of you got by with arguing with your parents. But it didn't take very long for me to figure out that wasn't going to work in my family. Consequently, I grew up feeling no agency for anything. I talked about that first grader when I walked into a new school. I had no self-concept, no self-respect. I grew up feeling no agency for anything, and because of that, I didn't know how to set any boundaries. Those were all set by my folks. And I think a lot of you had your boundaries set by your folks as well. And that goes forward to later life, and I wasn't equipped to set boundaries, so I didn't set it. But later, since trying to recapture my true spirit, I found that healthy boundaries were better for me and for everybody else in my new relationships. But I found it was very hard. Once you have not set boundaries, but someone else has, to walk those boundaries back to where I can be comfortable with them. And that's something I work on every day. Pleasing everyone. scriptures. You know, another part I read was, even as I try to please everyone in every way, which I thought was a very interesting thing, and we never try to do that. So respect. Respect for others, respect for ourselves. And the effect of violating that simple statement from God to love each other as I have loved you. It was just a statement. Something I didn't understand. Loving fellow humans. Love is such a difficult term in the English language, and I love what the Greeks say, how they define it. Agape, love of God for us, love of us for God. Philia, which is love for your brother, your fellow human being. Philatelia, which is love for oneself. I wish we had those better defined in our language, because love for others is hard to do sometimes. Respect generally comes before love, it seems to me, and I can respect someone without loving them. Lord knows, working in the university and in state government, I had a lot of those people who were, that I didn't particularly like, but I certainly respected them. And one of the major things I've learned is that my parents were good at, unfortunately, was the concept of listening to understand. I wasn't good at that for a long time. Listening to understand instead of to respond. I think by nature, a lot of us are an argumentative bunch. And yes, but it goes in way too many of our discussions. You got a good point, but mine's right, you know. Makes it a lot easier. All you have to do is listen to me and get it right. For me, it takes a conscious effort to set aside those lessons that I grew up with to actually look for the dynamic, try and look at cultural backgrounds, the way people react, or the way they act. If there's someone that bothers me, to try and take the time to get the backstory. You know, if Annie were grumpy, which I can't ever imagine, you know, it's important not to just say, you said something mean to me, so I'm going to be mean back, but to ask, what's wrong? Is there something going on that I can help with? Disarm the situation. Love yourself. That's a tough one for me, and possibly it might be for you. I found that my life lessons of just giving and giving and giving left me empty. I thought I was being filled by giving up myself. And I still feel that way, and it makes me feel good. But without boundaries, that giving is taken advantage of. And that's not good. And that's something else I've had to work on. So, So loving myself, loving ourselves, is the key to loving anyone else, really. To truly So the question is, can all of this from growing up be reversed? The corners are still there, but everything in between is dented, dimpled, torn, hardened. Can I reverse that? And that's what my search for finding my true spirit, that spirit that was given to me at birth and could well have been since the beginning of all that is. Can I get it back? Can I return this to being flat? Yes, of course we can. For me, it's introspection. It's caring, it's allowing, it's forgiving, it's all of those things. And that comes back down to where we have the simple four things that makes the Bible a pamphlet, if we just pay attention. Respect our fellow human beings, respect ourselves, love our fellow human beings and love ourselves. Now, I envision the portion of John where Jesus at the Last Supper, he knows that Judas is about to take off and give him up. He knows what's coming. He knows that the disciples, when he's arrested, are just going to disappear like a covey of quail. And he didn't want his lessons to go to waste. He thought, this is the last hour. For 3 years, I've been trying to teach you folks, all of you followers, how to be, what to be. I've used examples. I've used every method I can, you know, the miracles, you see me with the tax collectors, you know, every type of person. But I'm not sure you got it. So listen up. You've had 10 commandments. You know those real well. But listen, a new commandment I give to you. Love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another. And mic drop. Now, if you'll stand as you can, and sing with me and place to us, there's a spirit in the air.
Thank you.
That was one of my favorite parts. That's when we share the joys and concerns. So, if you have something you'd like to share, please come on up.
Hi, my name's Ben. I'm just going to give you all an update that Sarah and D'Artagnan and Downing are COVID-free, at least as far as their tests say. And much to my amazement, D'Artagnan is starting his senior year in high school.
Oh, wow.
I got a flyer from UUC. They will have another session of their hour comprehensive class, sex-ed class. And I thought it was neat, so they gave me a copy of it, and I thought I'd come over here and show it to you guys. And if you wish to get involved, you can contact the Reverend, and perhaps he can get you involved with UCC and have a class.
That contact person is me. Thank you, Bruce. Okay. I was looking for those flyers. So, if anybody has questions, I'm the contact.
Yes, if you have any questions.
I'm coming over there.
Elizabeth is doing the help project, so.
But you gotta write it down, and you gotta,
because and we're making a concerted effort to try to get our directory finalized, and several of you have not graced us with your photographs, so I'm available after service today, next week, week after that, to try to get your pictures. Looking at you, Jim, Rita, see me afterwards, thank you.
Michael, I went up to Grand Mesa yesterday because I didn't really want to camp overnight, but I had a great time visiting with our church members up there, and it was only like 61 up there, and raining some, so that was a nice change.
Hi, I'm Ken. I have a prayer of concern. My sister-in-law Janet, who I've asked for prayers for in the past, is entering final stages. They are going to start doing some radiation therapy for pain management. But for her and for her family and all of us, we will please keep everyone in our prayers. They said it could be 2 weeks, it could be 2 months. So please keep her in your prayers. And I've got a joy I want to share with you. I started a new hobby. I have a little pond in my backyard, and it's stocked with Madaka rice fish, which they're only about an inch and a half long, but they sparkle and shine in the sunshine. And they lay eggs on the roots of the plants. Mine, the eggs hatched, and I have about 50 little tiny, tiny babies walking all around, so now I'm the Madaka daddy.
Safe and keep them healthy. God, we're thankful for the wonderful weather that we've had for that camping trip, and for the fellowship of everyone who was up there, and the joy that they were able to share, the celebration of your world, and that we'll be able to take good care of it in the future. And we're so happy for new life, fish, people, spirits, that we all may have. And we ask that you hold Jan and all those who love her. Hold her close. Help her faithfully and comfortably through that transition. We ask that you make it as painless as possible. And as peaceful as possible. God, we do pray for the nation. We pray for wisdom. We pray for equality. We just pray that you can lead us to a better path. And dear God, we can't thank you enough with all of our requests. It seems like we usually only talk to you. There's a problem. But help us to celebrate all the joy and beauty that's around us. Peace. Shalom. Salam. And then the way you taught us to pray, hear our prayer. Our God, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation,